Once John Lee started a Dhamma talk by telling everyone in the room to make a dedication or determination that they wanted to see some of the results of their good karma tonight, whatever good karma they might have in the past, could it please show its results tonight? Apparently there was one monk, brand new monk, who decided he wanted to see the results of his past bad karma. So he made that determination. And they ended up having an epileptic fit. What this illustrates is a principle the Buddha taught about many times, is that what you're experiencing right now has lots of different potentials. And it's your current intention that makes the difference as to what you're actually going to experience. This is why meditation works. When it doesn't work, your intention may be right, but you don't know how to carry it out properly. There's a skill in how you approach the different potentials in the present moment. And we start with the breath, because compared to the mind, the breath is pretty blatant. It may be subtle compared to a lot of other things we're experiencing, but it's closest to the mind. And it's also one of the processes in the body over which you have the most control. You can focus on the breath energy anywhere in the body. You can make the breath long, short, fast, slow, heavy, light, deep, shallow. You can experiment. The potentials are there. It's simply a matter of learning how to be skillful and focusing on which potentials are going to be helpful to get the mind to settle down and which ones are actually going to be harmful. This is something you learn by trial and error. Because as long as you're dealing in the dimensions of space and time, everything you experience is going to be fabricated. Pain is fabricated. Pleasure is fabricated. The Buddha once talked about the foremost dhammas, and there are two types, he said. They're fabricated and unfabricated. Among the unfabricated dhammas, well, there's only one. It's dispassion, nibbana. Among the fabricated dhammas, the foremost is the path. This is something we're putting together, something we're learning to adjust, as in the factor of right concentration. You're adjusting the breath, you're adjusting your sense of the body. This is what the directed thought and evaluation and right concentration are all about, getting things to fit. Getting your awareness to fit with the breath, getting the breath to fit with the body, getting everything snugly together in a way that feels really good. Because you are trying to induce a sense of rapture and pleasure. These are things that are created. Sometimes they come easily, sometimes not so easily. But as you really get to know the body well, you find even when there are periods of pain in the body, there's still some potential someplace in the body for the rapture, for the pleasure. You can try the backs of your hands, your wrists. Just let them relax. Then think of that sense of relaxation spreading up the arms. You can try the feet. Relax your feet, relax your ankles, your knees, everything coming up the legs. As you breathe in, as you breathe out. And notice if the two processes are interfering with each other. If they are, try to allow them to meld. You're doing two things here. One is you're creating a sense of well-being in the present moment. That makes it easier to stay here. And secondly, you're learning about cause and effect. There's a lot to be learned through the manipulation of these energies. I was reading a while back, someone had an interview with a teacher in which they mentioned that they'd been adjusting their breath to make it easier to stay with. And the teacher said, well, that's fine, but you're missing an opportunity for insight, as if insight were simply a matter of watching things without doing anything. One, if that were possible, and the Buddha says, even your basic experience of the senses is already shaped by the way the mind is fabricating. So you might as well learn how to fabricate well. And as you're doing this, you get a lot more sensitive to the very subtle levels of how your intentions are shaping what you're experiencing right now. So you're not running away from insight. As you create concentration, you're actually gaining an opportunity to see things that a lot of quote-unquote insight practices actually cover up. They have you pretend that you're not doing anything, just sitting there passively watching and not doing anything at all. What that idea does is it drives underground a lot of the subtle fabrication that is going on right now. So you might as well do it openly, so you can really see what's going on. Take advantage of this fact of your experience, which is that you're shaping things all the time. Because as the practice gets deeper and deeper, you will be amazed at some of the things that are really the results of your intentions. Sometimes it's past intentions, but these present intentions go very deep. Some of them you're conscious of, some of them you're not. But they're there. And as the mind settles down and your awareness gets more subtle, you begin to realize that you're making choices that you sloughed over. You just thought they were part of the background noise. So we can't create the pleasure, the happiness. The Pali word sukha covers all kinds of things, everything from plain old ease, pleasure, to happiness and bliss. We can't create the bliss of the unfabricated by definition. It's just there. But we can create a path that will lead us there. It's like a road that takes you to the edge of the ocean. The road doesn't cause the ocean. In fact, the ocean was there long before the road. But if you follow the road, you arrive there. So we take a fabricated path that leads us to something unfabricated. That's when it really gets good.